My name is Kelis. People know me as a musician. That's what people mostly will probably recognize me for.
Grammy-nominated recording artist Kelis is known for her chart-topping hits. And throughout her career, she has made no secret of her passion for food. She trained at Le Cordon Bleu, released a cookbook, and her own line of sauces. And now, Kelis is taking her connection to food to a deeper level. She lives on her own farm in Temecula, California. That's just a few hours from South Central Los Angeles, where Ron Finley, the Gangsta Gardener, spreads his own message of urban gardening. You might recognize him from his Masterclass or his TED Talk on guerrilla gardening, which has amassed millions of views. In 2010, Ron planted fruits and vegetables on the parkway in front of his house, which violated an LA city code that he eventually got changed. Since then, he's worked to build gardens throughout LA and eliminate food deserts. We arranged for the two of them to chat about growing your own food, the relationship between Black people and the land, and how to handle a mean rooster.
You're very aggressive. So we ate three of them.
Well, you ate your roosters? That's horrible.
We got you. They were so mean.
How you doing, Kelis?
I'm doing good. I'm so glad we're able to do this. This is cool.
No, this is pretty dope. And you know, to get to do this with you, you know, now you are OG, you out there. What made you decide, I'm gonna get a farm?
I think the first thing initially was really space, right? The first thing was just wanting more space and wanting more freedom to be able to do the things that I wanted to do. You know, wanting to be able to say, like, I know exactly what's in this. I know exactly how long it took. I know that there's nothing funky that I can't pronounce or that I don't want to say or that I don't want my kids to have. Just all that stuff. And just wanting to have some more power, some more control, and some real legacy that I can leave my little people.
Well, we basically got into it for the same reason. To me, gardens represent freedom. I wanted it for beauty. I wanted to walk out and smell jasmine, and I wanted to see agapanthus and lilies, and, you know, I wanted hummingbirds and to fly on my shoulders and butterflies kissing me in the ears. So that's what I planted. You know, I tell people design, that's the whole thing is beauty. You know, beauty in, you get beauty out. And then it turned to the food, and I wanted to share this. We should know about this. How did we get so far away from this?
Somewhere along the line, this became unsexy to people, right? But to me, the sexiest thing in the world, like, this is the flyest thing I can do right now. This is everything. This is literally my rebellion. This is my, like, F you. This is my, in every possible way.
Is.
When you think about our food, right, and what people say is soul food and what our food really is, they don't really know what it is. You know what I mean? Like, we have this, like, weird bastardized different traditions that have been infiltrated. But if you go, you know, anywhere to the islands, you go to the continent, you see how people eat. They are healthy. They're strong. There's not a lot of fried. There's not a lot of dairy. It's just like we eat the way that we're supposed to eat has been taken away from us. I feel like the younger generations need to see that and need to understand that. And so I love the fact that, you know, when you say just Gangsta Gardener, I'm like, that is the best. It like sums everything up. Like, it just puts it all in this perfect package. I just think it was so smart.
I think the whole thing, Kelis, is a value thing. People don't see themselves, kids don't see themselves as being valuable. And that's why I'll kill you over a pair of tennis shoes. I'll kill you over a gaming console, you know, so because they think these things give them value and they don't really realize that we are the soil. You know, that's where we come from. We're carbon based. How do we show these kids how to give a fuck about something other than things is to me is what this is about. What was one of the first things you wish you knew when you started that you know now?
You don't have to till the land. I didn't know that. The ground was so compacted because it was a horse property before. So they had packed all the dirt down as hard as they could, so it was, you know, for the horses. You know, we're Googling, like, what do you do? And everyone's like, you need a tractor, you need this, you need that. We're like, okay, we're watering. We're trying to, like, wet the ground to make it softer. We're digging. We broke, like, the machinery was breaking. It was a disaster. So I call my mom. My mom had the most beautiful garden in the hood. I mean, beautiful. Tiger lilies and, like, freaking crab apple trees. Like, she just had all this stuff growing. And I would be like, how does she do this? Funny thing is, she sends me this video. This guy's like, don't worry about it. All you got to do is, like, you need some ground cover. He's like, let it sit, water it, and then check it out in a couple of days. You're like, what? So we went and we had a bunch of trees we had to cut. We went and made our own mulch. And then we just started laying the mulch out. I lie to you not, it's so crazy. I never tilled again. Game changing.
There's so many resources around us that we weren't taught that are resources. I tell people a leaf falls for a reason in a particular season. That leaf is doing so much work after it falls off. It's doing mad work on the tree from photosynthesizing and you know, feeding energy. And what are we taught to do? Get a rake and throw it in the trash. No, save those leaves. That's one of the lessons that I learned was that, you know, with compost was nothing ever dies. I think every school in the world, not just America, should show these kids how to have worm bins and the compost, because that's a way we can make them not only stewards of this planet and humanitarians, we can also make them entrepreneurs. Because imagine if you're 8 years old and you're collecting trash and all of a sudden you got compost or you got worm casting and now you're selling it, it's going to change your view. It's going to change your worldview of everything around you. So I heard you got animals named after musicians.
Yeah, well, just like my favorites, you know. So like we've got a Holstein cow and her name is Roberta Flack. And we've got Teddy Pendergrass is our bull. He's a black Angus. And it's because I'm just waiting for him to get it on at Whitney Houston.
And oh, my God.
Roberta Flack. We have a Huey P. Newton. We had a Stokely Carmichael. They're all roosters. And so they were fighting. I mean, they've attacked me full on, like where I'm like fighting for my life. Okay. They're very aggressive. So we ate three of them. I made sancocho.
Well, you ate your roosters? That's horrible.
I had to. They were so mean. I was like, what am I supposed to do with them? I was like, you know what?
Oh my God.
They're going to be in a nice stew, a good Puerto Rican stew. So
you're going to be sucking on his femur, right?
Oh, it's delicious.
That's terrible.
Like, yeah, I'll show you.
Oh my God. How has gardening changed your music? Has it had an influence on you, on your music?
I don't know if it's had like a direct
or
influence
farming,
on my
in
music.
Your case.
I think it's just like, I think it's overall just like my lifestyle. Like that's had a huge impact on how I write. Just because like you said, I've got a freedom now that like changed everything. To like take your shoes off and stand on dirt that belongs to you, that's a totally different feeling and it's a totally different thing. And I think for me, the freedom that it gave me and just the sense of like peace and power, I think like that definitely just my lifestyle, it changed my life.
You know, that's why this is gangster. You can't get more gangster than being a gardener or a farmer. This has everything to do with survival and of our species and of our culture. How do we get your cousins to realize that freedom?
From my perspective, the first thing is just really the education about what our actual history is, and it's not just slavery. We were agricultural experts, and we were growing things, and how we were growing them, and how we had water flow, whether it's aqueducts or whatever it was that was happening. That's what made them say, we want these people to come over because we are going to force them to do it for us. That's how the whole thing started. So just understanding that the land was ours and that there is something really beautiful and powerful in not allowing someone to dictate to you what the scope of your lifespan and your health should be and how you eat and how you are able to process everything. I think that's the first thing. I remember growing up in New York and just like I said, if it wasn't the summertime and that produce truck didn't drive up from the south, like my mom would take us, hated it. We would have to get on a train or on a bus to go all the way downtown. Cause she was like, the food here they're not giving us the right stuff up here. That's going to control our health, how long we live, how much we're paying to all of the things that happen. Like I think that's the first thing. I think it's really simply, it starts with educating our people as to what it really means.
Cities are designed for one thing and one thing only. And that one thing is commerce. Cities are not designed for people. They're designed to house people, but they're not designed for our betterment. They're not designed for our health. They're not designed for our safety. They're designed to house us to go to work for corporations and other, it's for commerce. And I tell these kids, you can change that. Matter of fact, that's your job, to change cities where they're more humane.
You're right, it's built for commerce. My mom used to always bring up George Jefferson. She's like, George and Weezy used to have a business and they had land. She goes, and then they got this new show that's now the big show and it's moving on up. And they're in an apartment. She goes, since when is an apartment better than land? My mom, I remember saying that a long time ago.
Right.
And she put it so cool. She was like, that's the, they fed us the Okie joke. She was like, how is that better? With all the money that I've made in my life, the fact that no one ever said, hey, the best thing you can buy is some land, because God's not making anymore. And like, I never, that would have been, I wish I'd been buying land this whole damn time. I didn't become a different person. I didn't like, I don't not care about fashion. I don't not care about my hair. I care about all those things still. And so there's something really, to me, like I want people to see the sexiness of it, because I think it was so purposefully taken away. And I think especially as young Black people, that is the best thing you can do. You know, when I, there's so many situations, even downtown and like in Harlem and all these places and down south, and where people are being moved out of their land, you know, and people are being, you know, eminent domain and all this nonsense, right? And they're being taken out of their land.
I was on Gullah Geechee land for the first time about a month ago in St. Simon's Island. And I thought I knew something about, you know, our history, and they just, just being down there. Cause I always thought Gullah Geechee, you know, was South, the Carolinas. I didn't know it went all across and then into Georgia and the whole nine. And to see that rich heritage and to see this beach where we lived, and I didn't see one Black person walking on the beach. This was literally our property. The Sunday morning show, they had a piece on there this week about, I didn't know Central Park was a Black neighborhood.
I was going to say that. Listen, it irks me to no end. Yeah, so like, no one talks about it though, right? It's like, because it drives me crazy, because my mom told us that as kids, again, we used to go to Central Park all the time. And she would always be like, this used to be where affluent Black people, there was a community of over 200 families that lived here, and they were thriving and living their best lives, and they got pushed out. And that happens so often. You know, when you look at historically, the fact that like, you know, in the 20s, that over 30% of the farms were owned by Black families, like Black people here in this country, and now we're less than 1%. I mean, that's crazy when we look at what, like you said, what the value is, right? And it's like, if we can't show people the fact that like there's, it's sexy because it's power, right? And they're not seeing it as power, because you're right, it's bigger than just the food. We have to know what's happening, what's being done, because we can't fight, we're not equipped to fight it if we don't even know what's happening. Like, people don't know what's happening, they have no idea.
Because we've been trained to live the life that's been designed for us and not design our own lives. It's up to us to change that.
It is. No, that's what you say is it's really one seed by one seed, right? It's like you plant the seed and just watch it grow, and it is what it is.
Isn't that amazing? I got the law change here in LA where you can grow food on the street. And I didn't see it for what it was. So I was at this conference with this one of these builders conference. I was talking to the CEO, and I'm like, yeah, I'm Ron Finley, you know. They call me the Gangsta Gardener and blah, blah, blah. He says, oh, you're that Ron Finley. And I'm like, man, they're one of the biggest land maintenance companies in the country. And I'm like, you don't know who I am. He said, yeah, Ron, we know who you are. He said, you got land use laws changed. Kelis, I never looked at it like that. He said, we know who you are. He said, who gets land use laws changed? And I'm like, it took him to tell me that, and being that, he would know
that's
that.
That's so good. So, yeah, I love that.
You know, but to us,
just,
it's like,
yeah, you're like, there's a goal, and you're like, this has to happen for me to do this. So you just do it. You're not even thinking about all the ripples that it causes, right? But it does. That's amazing.
Exactly.
So what's your next, like, what's your next step? Like, what do you want to do with the garden? Like, how do you feel like we can tell our cousins?
I think the magic is to get a group of people in that soil and watch them be seduced by it, because that's literally what soil would, it's the garden seduces you. And you know, you go out to check on something, you got your robe and your pajamas on, and you're outside because it's 5 a.m. And the next thing knows, like 11 o'clock, 12, honestly, and you haven't eaten, you haven't done nothing, and you're still in the damn garden.
Well, I want to welcome you out here, because I've been, honestly, I think about it all the time. I watch everything you're doing. If you ever feel like you just want to get out of the city and put your feet in some country dirt, We're only 2 hours away.
I'm mouthing whatever, okay?
Come on out here. First of all, I'm good at putting folks to work. I'll be like, run, you know what you're doing. Enjoy. All the right. Hands, okay?
I would love it. I would love it.